everyone. In this tutorial, we will be talking about floor plans. Floor plans are very helpful as they'll support your audience's spatial understanding and let them move faster through an object. As opposed to moving around via the hotspots placed on the actual panoramas, which only let you move to adjacent rooms, floor plans allow you to jump from room to room or even between floors. They are vital tools, especially in real estate, and it only takes a couple of clicks to add them. All you need to integrate a floor plan in your virtual tours is an actual digital floor plan file in JPEG or PNG and 3DVista Virtual Tour Pro. Please keep in mind that Virtual Tour Standard does not support this feature. In case you are a Virtual Tour Standard user and still want to make use of the floor plan option and many more, please don't hesitate to contact us for upgrade possibilities. Again, for the actual floor plan, any digital plan in PNG or JPEG will work. In case you don't have a digital floor plan at hand, you can easily create one with 3DVista's Floor Plan Maker or any of the common editing programs. Make sure to export and save the created plan as JPEG or PNG. Okay, so a couple of basics before heading into it. You can add various floor plans, which usually makes sense for objects with various floors. While I will be demonstrating how to add floor plans using computer-generated images, you can obviously add floor plans equally to virtual tours composed of real photography. The steps are the same. So this is 3DVista Virtual Tour Pro. Let's assume we already integrated all our panoramas. Now, in order to add a floor plan, we click on the tab Floor Plans and Add Floor Plan. If you have various floor plans and therefore various floor plan files, one for each floor, you can either select them all or add further files later on through this Add Floor Plan button on the bottom left. In case you need to switch the order of the floor plans because you mistakenly have the third floor before the second floor, for example, you can simply move the files around by drag and drop. So by adding the floor plan here, the program automatically adds a new viewer window in your virtual tour layout, which we can see in the Skin tab. This will be the window in which your audience will see the floor plan and will be able to interact with it, while the other window continues to be your normal viewer playing your panoramas and virtual tour files. Now, as you can see, the size and position of our floor plan viewer does not fit the size and format of the vertical floor plan. Therefore, we should move and resize the viewer until it fits our floor plan's format. So because your floor plan is essentially a skin element, this is where you're going to move it around. So whether you want it on the top right corner or on the bottom left, here in the Skin tab is where you actually place and size your floor plan. Remember that the settings on the right-hand side will always refer to the skin element you have currently selected in the list. You can select elements either by clicking on them within the canvas or by selecting them in the list, which might be safer especially when having many or overlapping skin elements. What's important to note is that while we have various floor plan files, one for each actual floor of the house, we only have one floor plan viewer. Why is that? Well, because we don't want to clutter our screen with as many viewer windows as we have floor plans. So instead, we will add a drop-down menu in which the audience can select the floor they want displayed on the floor plan viewer. You have to add this drop-down menu manually. Therefore, I create a container, which helps keeping various skin elements more organized. I drop the floor plan viewer into this container and add a drop-down menu as well. Now I can either move and arrange the elements within the container by dragging them around or by inserting actual data on the right-hand side to make sure they always stay at the very top of the container, for example. See how for the selected drop-down menu, the position is defined by the ticked left and top coordinates. When setting these at zero, you'll see the element jump up to the upper left corner of the container, where it will stay even when moving or resizing the container. If I now set the drop-down menu's size to 100%, I can be sure that the drop-down menu will always be perfectly placed within the container. The same goes for the floor plan viewer. So by selecting percentage here, my map viewer will always adapt to the container size. Should you not want your elements to resize when resizing the container, change the size back from percentage to pixels and it will remain independent. If you want to know more about how to deal with skin elements such as containers, buttons, etc., please hop on over to our skin tutorial. Whoops! Yeah, here we go. So this is the mistake that I was talking about earlier. I was trying to select the entire container within the canvas, but instead I picked up only the drop-down menu, which I'm now moving on its own. That's why we should really select the elements from the list on the right-hand side. Okay, now here in the preview you can see how the placement and size of the elements actually turned out. Two things. I can see that the map viewer element is actually too wide for my floor plan, so we get the margins on each side. Plus, the drop-down menu lists the wrong elements. It lists each panorama instead of each floor plan. Therefore, we have to go back to that element and change the drop-down content. I select only floor plans, and from now on it will only display the two floor plan items. The names of these drop-down categories are the names that your floor plan files had when you originally uploaded them. Should you prefer to label them first and second floor, you'd have to rename each plan in the floor plan tab. Now, secondly, I reduced the size of the container, which automatically reduces the map viewer as we set it to be 100% of the width of the container. And there we go, no margins anymore. Since you can't see the format of the floor plan within the map viewer and container of the skin tab, reducing the size of the container is a matter of trying until you see it fits in the preview. As you could see, this is really quick, however. Some of you might not want to let people zoom in and out of the floor plan. Should this be the case, you can simply go back to the floor plan tab, select the respective floor plan, and set minimum and maximum zoom levels to the same as the initial zoom. For consistency, do this for all of your floor plans. So much for the basics of floor plans. Now on to the most important part, the hotspots and radars. Radars will show your visitors where, that means in which panorama, they currently are and in which direction they are looking. Hotspots will let them jump to another room. Let's start with hotspots. Hotspots in floor plans means you place a hotspot, say a small icon for example, within your floor plan that will open the respective full-size panorama when being clicked on. For placing them, select the floor plan tab, click on one of the floor plans and go to the sub-tab Hotspots. Now, as you might know from normal hotspots within panoramas, you first select the format of the actual hotspot, so do you want it to be a polygon which you draw onto the floor plan, or do you want to upload your own image? I will upload my own image, a small dot, which I usually use as floor plan hotspot. Place it on the floor plan right at the spot that corresponds to one of your panoramas, so let's say the entry. Make sure to place it approximately where you feel the camera stood when taking the panorama, as this will imitate the position of your virtual tour user within the house. Same as with normal hotspots, you can change quite a few parameters on the right-hand side. When will the hotspot be visible, always or only on rollover, the type of cursor, maybe a tooltip. And lastly, but most importantly, you assign the hotspot's action. Up to now, the hotspot was merely a dot within your floor plan. Now, you will determine the action it triggers when being clicked on. Just as with normal hotspots, apart from opening a panorama, you can also play a video or choose one of the other actions listed here. So in our case, click Open Panorama and select the entry panorama, and done. Do this with all of your panoramas to let your audience move quickly around the house. We'll be right back. Now to add radars, you need to have hotspots established first. No hotspots, no radars, simply because the program does not know where to place the radar. To add radars, go to the floor plan tab. Select one of your floor plans and click on the subtab Radar. Select the first hotspot that you want to equip with a radar from the list on the right hand side and click Add. This automatically adds a radar to the hotspot. Click and drag the radar around until it exactly fits the field of vision of the panorama that you see on the right hand side. As you can see, now the radar just about includes the sofa and the fruit bowl. If you feel like you can't set up the radar accurately enough, you can also zoom and pan the panorama crop to the right of your radar. Zooming in will give you a more detailed view, and you can pan the panorama to a position which you feel is easier to capture with the radar, let's say the exact outer edge of the couch. Again, on the right column you get a lot more settings for the radar, so you can change the actual length of the radar, change its color and opacity, etc. Continue on to selecting the rest of your hotspots from the top list, and as you can see, the program automatically adapted the settings we just defined, so all your radars will have the same length, color and opacity without you having to arrange them all individually. The only thing you do have to arrange is the orientation of the radar. Should you want different radars though, you can manually change the parameters and determine different ones for each radar. And that's it, now you'll always have a radar indicating your current field of vision. Just a quick heads up, at the moment of filming this tutorial, the changes in the radar's length are not reflected in real time within the canvas yet, so I'll have to check it in the preview for now. This is something we will be fixing for the next update though, so you might not even be affected by that anymore. Here in the preview you can see that while I spin around, the radar spins with me. If you're not happy with the color or length of the radar, just go back and change them. Let's say we prefer a more subtle radar and want to change the length. For our example now, this is where we can clearly see to what extent we actually reduced the size of our radar. And that's it, people! Give it a go yourself and you'll see that with very little extra effort you can enrich your virtual tours and improve usability, which will surely be appreciated by your customers. Thanks for watching.